CDC has come out with this updated guidance just this past week to really try and get more updated with what's actually happening with COVID-19. So we're at a different place now from the start of the pandemic. Most people in the United States have either been infected or have been vaccinated, and we're in a different place as far as people having been previously exposed, less serious illness, fortunately, less people ending up in the hospital. And so they're trying to find more practical ways for us to learn to live with COVID, similar to how we live with influenza and other respiratory viruses, because we know we're in this for the long haul. It's become endemic. So with that, masking is still important. And they still emphasize masking as a tool to prevent yourself from getting infected if COVID transmission is high in your community, or if you have risk factors that put you at high risk for severe disease and there's COVID transmission in your community, you should really think about masking. They have eliminated quarantine if you're exposed. So if you're in the community, you're exposed to someone that you find out has COVID, and previously the CDC would recommend that you quarantine yourself and monitor for signs and symptoms. Now they're asking that someone that's got a high risk exposure to wear a mask for 10 days after that exposure. So really covering that time frame, whether you're vaccinated or not, really to make it simpler for people to remember and to consider getting tested 5 days or longer after that exposure so you can test to see if maybe you have asymptomatic infection. So that's what they've done with quarantining. They've kind of eliminated that, moved more to masking if you know that you've been exposed, testing if you have any signs or symptoms, at least testing days 5 or later after that exposure to see if you have COVID. They've also eliminated social distancing, this 6 feet or further away, recognizing that now people are back in circulation, there's no lockdown in place, people are moving around in public places where it's not really possible to do 6 feet of distancing. If COVID transmission is high, instead, they would recommend that you wear a well-fitting, high-quality mask to prevent yourself from getting infected, as opposed to looking at the 6 foot distancing to try and protect yourself. We haven't seen high levels of flu the last couple of years, which has been good, and probably largely attributed to the things that we're doing, the public health interventions that we're doing to try and reduce the transmission of COVID-19. So wearing masks, avoiding large crowds. So we've seen less flu influenza. I don't think people should be worried about influenza, but I do think people should still get the flu vaccine and be aware of flu activity, because flu is not gone. Information coming out just recently is showing that Australia is actually having more influenza this year than they had in 2019, before the COVID pandemic. So we may see some rebound of influenza activity, which is not surprising given that over the past couple of years during the COVID pandemic, less people have gotten the influenza vaccine. They've been getting their COVID vaccines, but not as frequently getting their flu shots. And there's less flu in general. And when people have less flu, that means that there's more people that are susceptible. They haven't had immunity from natural infection or the vaccine. So we have a little bit more susceptible population right now too. So there's definitely ample reason for flu to rebound potentially, and to potentially occur outside of the normal flu season that we normally see here. Normally we talk about the flu season from October through April. Last year we saw some cases in August. Certainly possible that we may see flu pop its head up outside of the normal October through April timeframe. So what I would recommend is to get the flu vaccine when it's available, and then just keep track, be situationally aware. There's lots of different ways you can find out about flu activity. You can go to your Metro Health, your health department. You can look at CDC Flu View to see what flu activity looks like in your area. This is a bit of a tricky question. So the CDC is kind of modifying their guidance, but they're not telling people not to worry. What they want to do is turn it to the individual themselves. So what I would suggest is that you do your own risk calculation. If you have medical conditions and you're not sure if you're at risk for more severe COVID disease, you should talk to your primary care doctor, ask them about that. Generally, people that are 65 and older or have chronic medical illness, especially underlying lung disease or cardiovascular disease, heart disease, are at higher risk for complications, or if you're immunocompromised, you're at a little bit higher risk and you should be aware of when COVID is circulating. And use that to make your decisions about when you should wear a mask. When COVID transmission is high, more important for people that are at higher risk to wear a mask. If COVID transmission is low, then we could probably relax some of those things. And then lastly, it's always important to get the COVID vaccine and to get the boosters as you're eligible to do so. There should be a new booster coming soon. So keeping on top of that, making sure that you're up to date is the best way to have some insurance so you don't have to worry. You could be aware without being as concerned. It's a great question. People are asking if there's less hospitalizations with COVID-19 than what we saw earlier in the pandemic, what are the concerns about getting COVID at this point? And it is good news that we're not seeing people as severely ill as we saw. We are still seeing some people end up in the hospital and in the ICU. Most of those people have underlying conditions that put them at higher risk. But we are still seeing people end up with long COVID. And most of those people, actually, the majority, don't end up in the hospital. And so there's still some potential long-term consequences from having COVID-19. So there are still reasons why we're recommending that people get the vaccine, wear the mask, take precautions when COVID transmission is high so they protect themselves. But we're trying to find this balanced approach so that people aren't worried all the time, because that's not sustainable either. So I think monitoring COVID activity, doing the things you can to protect yourself to reduce your risk of having some of these long-term consequences like long COVID. The updated COVID vaccine that people have been asking about, one that has a Omicron variant-based strain in it, has actually been approved by the United Kingdom for Moderna. Pfizer is also working on an updated vaccine. Really what we want is a vaccine with a strain in it that mirrors what we're seeing circulating in population. So both the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines actually have two strains, two types of SARS-CoV-2 virus in it, the virus that causes COVID-19. One is the original virus that started this pandemic that people have been getting in their COVID vaccines. The other strain is a Omicron variant-based strain. And the good news is that what they're seeing in lab studies on this, it shows this updated Omicron variant-based strain provides a really good immune response against the strains that are currently circulating, the BA.5 and BA.4. It's still recommended for people that are eligible, so people that are over 50 or have underlying conditions that make them immunocompromised, that they get that extra dose, that second booster, because it's still not entirely clear when we're going to have access to this updated Omicron variant-based vaccine from both Moderna and Pfizer. It's hopeful that will be sometime in September, October, but sometimes there can be manufacturing delays, other issues, as we all know about supply chain issues. It could be a little bit later. So it's still recommended that if you're eligible for that second booster, that fifth dose, that you get it. Otherwise, if you're not, hang tight. Hopefully this Omicron variant-based vaccine will be available soon. At this time, the CDC and the federal government really want people to get every booster that they're eligible to do so, and are saying that they are not going to prevent somebody that gets a booster now from getting that Omicron variant-based booster that when it becomes available. They really want to have both. And ideally, we get onto some sort of schedule similar to what we have with the flu vaccine, to where people are getting it annually. So they'll want people to get the most up-to-date Omicron variant-based vaccine when it's available too. Novavax vaccine is approved, and it provides a nice alternative to people that have concerns about the mRNA vaccine platform that both Moderna and Pfizer use, or they've had a strong reaction to it and aren't able to take it. Novavax vaccine is actually based on more traditional vaccine platform technology. It uses a subunit protein, so a protein, not the entire virus, from that SARS-CoV-2 virus that causes COVID-19, and then a little, what's called an adjuvant, but basically it's a little stimulant that makes your immune system react to that protein and develop antibodies to protect you. And this is similar to other vaccines that people have received in the past historically. The efficacy data, or how well it works, is actually quite good. And in the data that's comparable to the Moderna and Pfizer, it was just a little bit less effective than Moderna and Pfizer, but very close. It's about 90% compared to 93 and 95%. So Novavax has a very good efficacy and study, very robust clinical data. It's been through a lot of trials, just like the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines, but it uses this more traditional platform that for people that have had issues with the mRNA vaccine platform, I would highly encourage them to talk with their doctors or sign up to get this Novavax vaccine.